All right, so today we are doing what I've decided is a good compromise. We're going to tier rank my like favorite books. I was going to try and do like my top 10 fantasy and my top 10 sci-fi and my top 10 non-SFF. I made those lists and I felt so constrained. I felt so weird. I was like, I can't rank these things and I don't like this. I was feeling weird. I didn't like doing it, especially with some of these being so nostalgic favorites. Like, I feel like for a book to become a favorite, it falls into other boxes. So what I decided to do, what I think is also just more fun, is I took those three lists that I had made and I put them into this tier ranking list, and I'm gonna rank them. And so therefore, you guys get the joy of watching me have to compare my favorites to each other, but I feel a little bit better about it because it's not quite a constricted linear ranking system. So we're gonna try it out. Let's see if I can remember how to do this, because I have not done a tier ranking in a while. I think my last one might have been when I did my completed series tier ranking, which if you've never seen it and you're new here, I ranked all the series I've ever completed, which is quite a bit and quite a lot of popular series. I read a lot of popular SFF before joining BookTube, so if you've ever been like, have you ever read X series? There's like a good chance that the answer is yes, and I haven't talked about it here, but I do have that video. And I haven't done this in a minute, so let's see what happens. So here we have the screen. So I've kind of made five tiers that are definitely wishy-washy, and it's kind of in order of importance. So the first one is will read forever. Like, I think originally I wanted it to be will reread till the day I die, but that seemed a little wordy. But that's what I mean. Like, this is a favorite. I'm going to reread it like tens of thousands of times. Not really, but maybe 10 times. Like, that's a realistic thing for me. I am an avid rereader. I typically read a lot of favorites over and over again. So if that's how it's a favorite for me, that's where it goes. So that's like our top tier. Our next one is like blew me away. So it's just like, maybe it's not something I could reread forever, but I'll reread a few times. It knocked my socks off. I still think about it. It's like a higher level. Like, it blew me away. Then we have want to reread. These are books that are favorites, but I haven't reread them yet, but I desperately want to. Like, I've acquired the books and I want to reread them, and they're just not quite at blew me away territory. Like, because blew me away, I could have books I haven't reread yet, but they just like had that extra stuff. We've got sticks with me, books that like maybe I don't necessarily want to reread, but like I think about them a lot. They stay with me. They are always in my head. I am recommending them to people in my real life and on BookTube all the time. And then surprised me. A book that like, it doesn't really make sense that it's a favorite, but I was just so surprised. I was just like, what? All right, and so we'll see if this works out, if I made reasonable categories or if this is all gonna go real weird. But they're all in alphabetical order, so we're gonna hop between the three genres. And so the first one is A Court of Mist and Fury, which I have to admit is a favorite. I think this one is going to solidly go into the surprised me category. It used to be will reread forever, and for all I know, maybe it will be that. I have reread it three times, but I don't know if it's going to have the longevity I need it to continue to reread. I say that every time, but then every November I pick it up. Like, I pick it up every Thanksgiving. At least that's what I've done for the past 3 years, so who knows. If you somehow don't know what this series is about, it's a fantasy romance series. You follow this woman, Feyre. There are fae, immortal creatures. There is some attempt at a political plot, but what I like about this story is her recovering from her depression and PTSD and following the romance. It's what I like. But let's go into some other ones that were more used to me really loving, and that is A Memory Called Empire. And this one's going to be in the blew me away category. I have reread this now twice, and both times that ending, woo, it is one of the best endings I think I've ever consumed, and that both times, I forgot what was going to happen on the reread, and both times I was just like jaw on the floor like, what? What? It's a really great sci-fi. I have a whole review for it. I ramble a lot about the thematic content I really like and why I love it so much. The sequel's also good, so this like counts actually for the duology. Although I do believe the first book blew me away more, but the second book I had more fun reading. And I have a review for both of those if you're curious. An absolute remarkable thing. This one's going to be another surprised me. because this was one I just picked up. It was last June. I had just finished an audiobook. I needed an audiobook. Audrey from Perpetual Pages was currently reading this one or had been reading it recently. And I asked them, hey, do you think I would like this? Should I read it? And they like were like, yes. So I picked it up, devoured it, devoured the sequel as well. I really like this near future sci-fi series. I think it's really great. I think the audiobook is very much paced like a really engaging podcast. Like for me, that's how it worked out. And I was so surprised that it was like my thing. I don't know why. I had seen it around and I just had no idea if it would work for me. And I devoured it. It was something that brought me a lot of joy when I read it in a time where I wasn't having a lot of joy. Joy was in short supply. So reading that story was really great. And then we've got Catfishing on Catnet. Oh, where to put you? I think this one is also going to be in Surprised Me and maybe slightly above Absolute Remarkable Thing. And this includes the sequel Chaos on Catnet, because this isn't necessarily something I could see myself rereading unless I really wanted the comfort read. But it's a series I could see myself continuing to read installments of. And I really love it. And like when I picked it up, it's a young adult sci-fi series and young adult's not my typical age range. I picked it up, read it in like 2 days, completely fell in love with all of the characters. I have a review for the series if you want to hear more rambly thoughts, but if you've been here for the last couple months, you know, I really like it. And then the Dababod trilogy, City of Brass. I think this one's going to go in, because we're including the whole trilogy, and this is going to go to Want to Reread. I have actually reread the first two books already, but I haven't reread Empire of Gold, and I've never read Empire of Gold physically. I only listened to that in audiobook, which was great, but I would love to actually, like, in a couple years, like, I could see myself in, like, 3 to 5 years rereading the whole thing, and it's going to be such a cozy, character-driven fantasy reread for me. I can just see that. So it's going to be great. Next one is Dune. I think we're going to put Dune in Styx with me. Because Dune is so influential and you can see it. And I've read it twice now. And I am slowly considering reading more of the series as Brittany keeps talking about it. I am curious. But it's definitely something that's not perfect. But I was so surprised when I picked it up because it reads very modern. Like if you're ever nervous about classic sci-fi, I felt that this had very modern world-building execution, personally. It's not very, direct in some of its execution, but it felt very normal to me. The characters felt very familiar to me. And this is a book that so many other books base their characters and world building off of, and that's really interesting. So it sticks with me. I'm super excited for the movie, just to see it all brought to life and have something that's probably paced a little better, because I think having the Hollywood treatment might help with the pacing of the story. The pacing in that one is a little all over the place, but I have to admit that when I think of like favorite sci-fi, I was really captivated when I read that the first time. And then we have Elantris, that is, we'll reread forever till the end of time. Moving on. I am in, not the minority, I feel, but like on the book internet, Elantris doesn't get a lot of love. I love Elantris. It's my favorite or second favorite Sanderson book on any given day. I understand that maybe if you didn't read Elantris first, or maybe Elantris wasn't your entryway into adult fantasy like it was mine, it might not be as good for you. But for me, Elantris was my gateway into, oh, books can do this. And I'm so nostalgic for it. It's my baby. I love it. I'm like a proud mom. I know the book is not actually that great, but to me, the book is everything. So I love Elantris. It is very different from other Sanderson books. It's not as action-packed. It's definitely a quieter story. You're focusing on 3 point of views, and if you find one of those point of views boring, which on most people's first read, I know exactly which point of view they normally find boring, but he is so much more interesting on rereads. It could drag. I can see it. But for me, it's nostalgically perfect. So, yeah. Next one is Eleanor Oliphant is Completely Fine. This one is one that surprised me. So I have a local book club and I always joke that it's like my vegetables for reading. Not because fantasy and sci-fi are not quality reads, but if it weren't for this book club, I wouldn't read literary fiction or historical fiction or contemporaries. Like I just wouldn't. I think this one's more of a contemporary than literary fiction, but I could be wrong. I really don't know what genres are. And I read it only because I had to. I did not know what it was about. We just vote for books, and I usually vote on the books that are the shortest, because time. And I was reading it, and I read it in like 2 days, couldn't put it down. I was so surprised at how much I cared about this character, and I thought it subverted some tropes because it could have easily been a different genre, is what I would say. I could see it going a different route, becoming kind of a classic, comfortable movie plotline, and it didn't do that. And it had a lot of character mystery and intrigue. It had a lot of a character having to grow and deal with things, and I mean, I still think about it. So maybe I should move it up to Stick With Me, because it is also one that I think of recommending to friends, or I think about that time in my life when I read it, and it was also a time where escapism was really big for me, so, like, it's a weird book to escape into, but, like, it really was something that I could just, like, hyper-focus on, and it was, like, a bad week at work. So, yeah, we're gonna move it up to Sticks With Me, but I really do like that book. And then we've got Evicted. Whew! That one's going into the top of Stick With Me. I should reread it. I should, but I don't want to, because it's a hard book. It's so hard. But man, so it's a very readable nonfiction. It's definitely written with a narrative twist, but the content is so hard. This person travels around Milwaukee, talks to different people in different states of living conditions, mostly people on the verge of being evicted and going through that eviction cycle. And you talk about that cycle and what gets you trapped in it and how hard it is to get out of it. You see it from different demographics. I think we have a single Black mom, we have a white person in a trailer park. There's a third perspective and I'm forgetting it because it was a long time ago. And it's hard because you don't want to believe this is real. Like, you don't want to believe that this is how things work. There are some stories that are brought up and you're like, really, that's how it works? Like, there's a whole thing about how a call for domestic abuse gets put in the same category as a noise complaint, which is negative for a landlord. So a landlord does not want someone to live there who will create noise complaints, so will then further punish this person who is already suffering from domestic abuse. And that's a thing that our legal system allows. it's insane. There's a lot of harsh truths, and it's also written in a very accessible way. Like, if you didn't know it was nonfiction, you could imagine it's a story, and you almost feel guilty because you enjoy it like you would enjoy a narrative, but it's, like, tragic. So, that one sticks with me. I should reread it, but I don't really want to. It makes me really sad. If I wanted to explore that topic more, I think I'd want to pick up a different nonfiction to, like, learn more specifics. Like, this was a very good intro into that topic. And then we have Exhalation by Ted Chiang. Ooh, this one's blew me away, a little bit above A Memory Called Empire. It's also, like, I want to reread it, like, so bad. Like, Evie is thinking about reading some of the short stories and talking about them in more depth on her channel, which, like, I'm very excited to have that excuse, maybe, to reread them again. Like, just, like, it's one of my only 5-star short story collections. I talk about it at length on this channel. I love Ted Chiang's brain, how he answers scientific questions. Literally, his mind blows me away. The way he can concisely tell a story and world build and character develop. There are few people as good as Ted Chiang is. Now we have Exit West. This one sticks with me. I think I'm gonna put it above Dune. So for those who don't know, this is kind of literary science fiction. I mean, I think you would more likely find it in the pure fiction section of your bookstore. They would not be in your science fiction section, but it does have a sci-fi element. That is, doors are opening all over the world, and you go through a door and you end up somewhere else. It basically erases borders in any conventional way. You cannot have border control because of these doors. So that's the purpose of the sci-fi element. And then you're watching our kind of near future world respond to the fact that you can't control borders, so refugees can just go anywhere. You don't have governments that can say no or here's the quota. And there comes a point where you have to just accept that there is this mass mobility available. And we follow this change through this one couple. And they're in a Middle Eastern country, and it's never mentioned which Middle Eastern country because location doesn't matter. Like, that's, like, the whole point. Oh, maybe I should move this up to want to reread. Yeah, it's going up to want to reread. I really like Exit West. I don't even know where my copy is. I actually bought a copy. I could buy another one. It's not a big deal. because I think I donated it or gave it to a friend to read because I liked it so much. It's just, I really like discussions about immigration and refugee crises, and I think sci-fi is a really good way of being like, okay, we're all talking about solving this problem with the tools that we have, but what if one of those tools is gone? Like, what if we cannot control who ends up where? So say you already have this many people here and you can't stop them from coming, then what is the humane response? What do we do? And it also has this couple that are just like, their relationship is so real that it's also like crushing. It's a lot. Like, it goes through some real beats that you don't always want to see. Like, it's not a romanticized romance. It's a very real relationship between these two people. Man, that book, I miss that book. Oh, His Dark Materials also will reread forever. Do I like it more than Elantris, though? Ooh, I like it more than Elantris. I do. How? I didn't see that coming. Oh, His Dark Materials. I think it's probably because His Dark Materials is the series that taught me how to hurt. And I'll leave it at that. It's, you know, it's a book that's held up for me. I've read it as an adult. Like, I read it when I was 24. I read it when I was of the age group I think it's marketed for. I read it when I was 12 or 13. And that was the series that taught me that books can have stakes, and that stakes are awesome in books. It's also not surprising to me at all that I love science-based magic systems now that I, like, rewatched, well, not rewatched, I was watching His Dark Materials TV show, and I'm like, oh my gosh, look at all the physics in this magic system that I didn't notice when I was a kid. And then I became a physics major. So it's like an Angela thing. I just really like it. Yeah, and like Animal Companions also. So yeah, rereading forever. I do have this nice copy, but I also have my favorite paperbacks. I got it in multiple editions. All right, we've got Hyperion, which is solidly a want to reread. I'm actually hoping to reread it this summer. What is time, right? I don't even know. But Brittany's been reading it for the first time, and I'm just remembering how awesome it is. Like, it's a crazy, it's called a canto, so there's four books, and it's like sci-fi horror. It's definitely kind of has some literary elements in the first book, at least. The second book's just like action-packed. There are just harrowing, haunting moments that you think about forever. Like, I talked to Justine about it, and we're both just like, oh yeah, that short story, that moment. Like, it's been years, and there are still moments that like stick with me. And I really want to reread it now because I read it back in my early days of science fiction. So, like, I was able to read it. But now that I'm more comfortable in certain tropes and now that I'm a more patient reader, I'm really excited to get into that one again. Interior Chinatown. That one is surprised me. And we'll put it above Catfishing on Catnet. I don't... Or do I want to put it in Want to Reread? It's so new that I don't know where it falls on this. It's one of these three tiers. I think right now it has to just be in surprised me, because that's what happened. It just legit surprised me. I was not expecting to read it in a day. It is one of the best ways to talk about the themes that it talks about for me, and I really do want to parse it out and reread it one day. I believe I have a copy, so it's totally possible, but for right now, it's really hard to tell where it will fall because it's just such a new favorite. That's where I'm going to put it. We have Just Mercy, and this is another one that sticks with me, and I want to read more in the space, but I don't think I'll reread this nonfiction. This is, oof. So this nonfiction, it's rough. It's written by a lawyer, and he does a wonderful job making it accessible. And every other chapter is, there's one actual like storyline of a case he works on. That's like a case of someone who's been put on death row who literally did not do anything wrong. There's no evidence, but I think it's in Alabama, and it's a black man in our justice system. So there's that. That's rough. And then the other alternating chapters are just him talking about different parts of the legal system with prisons, with, like, I think minors and pregnant women. And this man himself has done so much work to change things for the better, like at the Supreme Court level. So educationally speaking, it's really rough to read, but really important. And I do think it has a good narrative flow. It's a good read. You should definitely read it. There is the movie, but the movie only focuses on the main narrative, so you kind of miss all of the other information. So it depends on how educational you want your experience with this piece of work to be. I haven't actually even watched the movie. So there's that one. We've got La Rose, and this one's one I really, really want to reread. Oh, I loved this book. This book was another surprise. It's by Louise Erdrich, and let's see, we read it for book club, and I had to moderate this book club, so I had to read it. And I was like, fine, I don't know what this is about. The synopsis sounds boring. That's like me in like 80% of contemporaries or literary fiction. I'm like, nothing here intrigues me. I have no reason to read this work. And I picked it up and I fell in love with this family. I fell in love with following them and just, it's like very slice of life while watching them recover from this grief and trauma. And I loved it so much. So I really want to explore that again. It's also like, I'm gonna call it contemporary, but also you could think of it as historical fiction because it's very much, it's important the time it's set in. You couldn't just lift it and put it now because the time is late 90s, early 2000s, and it's pivotal that it's there. You know, 9/11 is kind of a small part of it. You can't ignore how the Bush administration and everything shapes the narrative of that work. And now we've got The Black Prism by Brent Weeks, and I'll put that in want to reread. I did like it enough that I'll want to reread it, and with its twists and turns, yeah, I want to reread it. There are some things that look very different when you know certain things, and it's very fun and fast-paced. I love the character arcs. Like, there are characters I straight up don't like in book one that I'm like rooting for so hard in book five. I wouldn't say book five is like the perfect ending, but it's a good enough ending, if that makes sense. Like, it didn't drop the ball, at least. Did it stick the landing, like, completely? No, it had like a little hop. Like, Vino Gymnastics had a little hop. So, that's where I'll put that. Little Fires Everywhere. This one's just gonna go in the bottom of Surprised Me. It was very fast-paced. What I think makes it a favorite of mine is it's one of the few books that exist that took place where I grew up. This takes place in a town right next to where I live called Shaker Heights. My church, when I grew up, was in Shaker Heights. I know that neighborhood. I know the Yours Truly that they go to in the book. It also is in the 90s. I grew up in that neighborhood in the 90s. So there's a lot there. I don't think it's like an amazing book on its own in terms of like plot and its thematic nuances, but I also blaze through it. It's like a perfect airplane read. So I had a really good time, and I like seeing my home depicted by a native in the book. She's also, I believe, from Shaker Heights, so that's really interesting. Oh, we got Mistborn. We'll reread forever. And I'm including the Mistborn trilogy in that, like just the Era 1. Era 2 I do like, but it's not like a favorite. It's like fun. It's like a 4-star series. I enjoy my time immensely. And then we got Machineries of Empire, and that one is also a blew me away / want to reread. Do I need to say more? If you've been here, you know I love Machineries of Empire. I have a review, if you're at all like, what's she talking about? It's a sci-fi series. It's military sci-fi. It's bananas. It's confusing. You just gotta trust it. General Jadao is everything. Poor Cheris just gets punished for working too hard. It's great, okay? It's great. Also, Yoon-Ha Lee has an amazing Twitter account where all I do is see his cat. So if you want to follow an author who just posts cat content while they're working on works in progress, highly recommend. All right, we've got Once Upon an Eid, also one that surprised me. Or is it sticks with me? I think it surprised me. So this is a middle grade short story collection that I don't talk about that much because there's not usually a time for me to talk about it. Like, I talk about it when I talk about short story lists, but that's about it. Don't really have middle grade lists. I don't even have contemporary lists, so it doesn't come up very often. I loved it. It was a wonderful way for me to familiarize myself with Eid, the holiday, that is actually occurring, like either the week of or the week after you're seeing this video. Actually, yeah, I think it's happening 2 days after you're seeing this video. That's when Eid's happening. And I loved it. I think this was the short story collection that made me realize, Angela, you probably should read more middle grade. Because I just loved hearing these stories of children at the holiday season, because being a child during the holidays is just, it's such a relatable experience. You have great holidays, you have disappointing holidays. There was a lot, and I really, some of them hurt me, some of them made me so happy I wanted to cry. Like, the emotional roller coaster that short story collection took me on was just wonderful, and I really, like, I don't know why I picked it up. I believe it was a recommendation probably from Quarantine Pages, and it just completely surprised me. I loved it so much. We got Pachinko. That is also a solid want to reread. Oh, yeah. So Pachinko's another book club book that I'm like, what? So this is a really long one, too. It's, like, actually a tome. It's, like, 450, 500 pages. It's a pretty big one. And this is the book that actually taught me a lot about the invasion of Korea by Japan in the early 20th century and about how there's still a lot of cultural tension today. As we follow, this is a generational story of a family from Korea who transplants to Japan, and it's through the majority of the 20th century. We see family members fall in love. We see family members get crushed. There's a whole bunch of stuff that happens, and it's a roller coaster, and the writing is stunning, and I really appreciated learning things too. Like, it was a historical fiction that I fell in love with. I have an ebook copy. I bought a physical and made everyone in my family read it, and now I stole that copy back so it could be on my shelves so I can read it one day. Yeah, really like Pachinko. Red Rising. That's also, it's like the same level of the Lightbringer series, is something I want to reread. It's a fun, good old time, and it scratches a very specific itch of, like, twists and turns Yeah, and I really do want to reread it when we finally, one day, whenever that is, get the third book for the second saga. Because this is just for the original Red Rising that I'm putting in the tier list. Because the second trilogy is good, but it's not a favorite. But the first three, like, they were amazing vacation reads. I was just like, what? Like, it was perfect. Like, it was all-consuming. I read them so fast, so you feel, like, accomplished. They were great. Redemption in Indigo. This one blew me away. What can I say? I love Karen Lord. I want to reread it. When I read the first sentence of that book, it stole my heart. Like, that was a first sentence stole my heart book. It's such a great folktale retelling. It's perfect for me. Like, it's literally like, where has this author been my whole life? And the answer is Barbados. But I love Redemption in Indigo. It stole my heart. I just actually got, as you can see maybe in the tiny screen, Unraveling, which is the sequel. Yeah, that one blew me away. Similarly, The Best of All Possible Worlds, which I do think I'm actually putting significantly higher up. The character relationship developments in that book. So good. So good. So my thing. I mean, I don't know yet if it will be a reread forever. I haven't even read it once yet after the first time, so we'll see. But I have a review for that. It's my favorite book of 2021 so far. I love it. It's if you like optimistic science fiction, you need to pick it up. Like, you need to. The next is The Deep by River Solomon. This is also a want to reread. I think I'll put it behind Exit West. Right? I don't know. The Deep by River Solomon is a really interesting work. If I can find it, I'm going to put Nikita's blog post down below, because she was talking a lot about how this is actually kind of a work of fan fiction in a weird way, because of how this story has evolved through media, because it used to be like a song and it's become a novella, and it's just really interesting. This is one of the tightest novellas I have consumed. I know some people have complaints about the plotting, but for me, the world building, the plot, the thematic messages were all extremely tight. It was the perfect length for me when I read it, and I even have a physical copy in hardback. Can't wait to reread it one day. Okay, The Last Wish. I am unsure. I think it's going to have to go and want to reread, or I think for now it's going the top of Sticks with Me, because I just finished the series, and this is just for The Last Wish. Like, some of these pictures encompass the series. This one's just The Last Wish. That one I could reread and be happy, but I might not, so it thinks it's probably going to just stick with me, because it is so good at what it does with the subversion of fairy tale retelling and giving me a monster hunter that I really like. So I think it's going to go with Sticks with Me. Similarly, The Library at Mount Char, which I talk about sometimes, like it's in my standalone fantasy book recommendations video. This book's bananas. This book's absolutely bananas. It's insane. how to describe it? Well, if you don't like gore, don't read it. It's pretty graphic in a lot of its physical, gory scenes. What is it about? It's about these children who are adopted by a weird dude, and he's not a very good father figure, and they all have specialties, and this one character has a specific specialty, and she has a revenge plot. And that's a very simple way of describing the plot, but it's bananas. Like, it's insane. I hear people compare it to Middle Game, and I can kind of see it because Middle Game also has kind of a bananas plot, but I think, for me, what I love in Middle Game are, like, the character relationships, which are not the strength in Library at Mount Char, but man, does the Library at Mount Char stick with me, and man, did I read that book in 3 days, and it consumed my life, and I still think about it, I still recommend it. I kind of want a copy, but, like, I don't really love the cover, but I do like the cover, and do I want it in hardback or paperback? Maybe if I see it in the wild one day. Now we have Radium Girls. This will also stick with me, as a lot of nonfiction do. This book made me angry. Ugh, I just hate when we know science and we know when things are bad and we just ignore it. Ooh, it makes me angry. It also is what leads to miscommunication and misinformation in science, because people are always like, well, we didn't know this, and now this happened, and people, like, you know, think that bad things will happen to them. And it's like, no, people knew things, they were just hiding the information, because it's capitalism. Yeah. And it's, like, actually really important, because without these women in the, I believe, 20s doing this work, by the time we're actually really doing a lot of radiation stuff in the 40s, we wouldn't have had the protections in place. Because it wasn't as brought to the forefront. It's a really good story. I highly recommend it. Sword of Kai Gen. Ooh, this one is at the end of Blew Me Away. I do want to reread it. But it's also, like, perfect in how it is in my memory. But, like, it was my favorite fantasy book of 2020. It's phenomenal. Like, every complaint any human has, like, there's a whole thread in my Discord right now of people talking about things that they loved and things that were like, eh, and I'm just like, no, it's perfect. It's absolutely perfect. It's not what I say. Like, I allow people to actually have reasonable discourse. I'm just over here like, no, no, no. It's perfect. It's the best. And that's how I want it to be. There, there. This one is one that really sticks with me, that I really recommend to a lot of people. So if you want a contemporary look at, I can't remember the tribes that are involved, but it's written by a Native American author about contemporary Native American experiences. You have multiple POVs, and there's kind of this climax where they all intersect, and it's really good. It's really good. I highly recommend making sure you get a copy that has the character list, because I do know for some people that's confusing. As a fantasy reader, I've been trained by many an author to just learn how to categorize that real fast for my reading experience. That's just a trial by fire thing I've learned. But There, There is a really, really good story. I highly recommend it, and it sticks with me so much. Like, the things that are brought to life there, things you don't think about if you're not in a community, to be able to hear that and, like, internalize it and think about it is, like, really important. We've got Warbreaker. This will be a reread forever. I've already read it, like, 3 or 4 times. Who I need to talk about, Warbreaker, or The Way of Kings, really, like, the Stormlight Archives. I literally own them in very expensive copies. If you do not know that I love the Cosmere, I love the Cosmere. I really love it. I don't talk about it all the time because I feel like it's more fun to talk about new books to me, but yeah. And then we've got the Winter Night Trilogy bringing us in, and this is one that I think is Blew Me Away. Or do I put in the same level as Dhaffabod? I think it's the same level as Dhaffabod, because I also just reread it recently. Yeah, that's where it belongs. So, Winter Night Trilogy, I have a review of Should You Read for that. It is beautiful. It's such a good story about this woman, Vazia, in 14th century Russia, and her relationship with magic, and her family, and the politics, and it's amazing. Highly recommend. Editing Angela here. If you haven't noticed, there is no NK Jemisin on this tier ranking list, and that is a huge mistake. I had it on my list, but I guess while getting the pictures together for this tier ranking sheet, it made it in the wrong place, and we're gonna fix it because this video cannot exist without my two favorite NK Jemisin series. So let's start with the Broken Earth trilogy. This is solidly top of Blew Me Away. I am about to reread it, and honestly, after that reread, it will probably be and will reread forever. Obviously, I can't know for sure, but like, it is one of the best completed series I have ever consumed. Now, the other one, the Inheritance trilogy, is a solid want to reread, and also top of that category because knowing what I know, knowing where it's going, I just cannot wait to experience it again for not the first time, but it's going to feel like it because the framing is going to feel different to me because the ending, like knowing where it's going, I cannot wait. So sorry for that, but now you guys at least know that it was a mistake. NK Jemisin is here, and that's where her books would be put.
Yeah, let me know what you think of any of these. And, you know, if you have any strong opinions of things that maybe aren't on this list, don't come at me. And if you want to leave an emoji, leave like a star. I feel like stars are nice. I don't make you guys leave stars often. Like, if you liked it, subscribe if you want to, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.